Nightmare on Elm Street series is one of the most successful horror franchises of all time. Freddy Krueger quickly became a pop culture icon in the 1980s, spawning a mountain of merchandise from t-shirts to action figures. Okay, that one's just wrong. In the original film, Freddy didn't talk quite as much as he would in later sequels. It was also a pretty scary movie for its time. Freddy Krueger started out as a dark, evil, and twisted villain. But as the 80s progressed and bled over into the 90s, Freddy became less and less scary until finally he was practically a parody of himself. The makeup even changed, becoming more stylized and almost looking like a rubber mask instead of actual burnt flesh like in the first films. He underwent a transition from full-on villain to a kind of wisecracking anti-hero, and the dream sequences got more and more elaborate and ridiculous. So I wanted to take a look back over the series and discuss Freddy's rise to horror dominance and descent into absurdity. This is the rise and fall of Freddy Krueger. The first Nightmare on Elm Street was a huge hit. The premise was very original, and it took the blossoming slasher genre in a whole new direction. He wasn't some mutant in a mask randomly killing teenagers. He was a supernatural entity who could invade your dreams. Any other killer like Jason or Michael Myers, you could conceivably escape from. But Freddy got you when you fell asleep. And we all have to sleep sometime. So if you were on his hit list, tangling with him was inevitable. And if you woke up before he got you, he'd just be waiting there the next time you fell asleep. As I'm sure we all know, Freddy Krueger had been a child killer. When he got off on a technicality, the parents of Elm Street took the law into their own hands and burned Freddy alive. Now disfigured and bucking for revenge, he torments the teenagers of Elm Street in their dreams. And if he kills you in your dream, you die for real. I saw this movie at an age where I was afraid to go to sleep afterwards. Freddy was a creepy villain that captivated audiences. So, of course, that meant there had to be a sequel. I mean, they left the door wide open for it at the end. No pun intended. Nightmare on Elm Street 2, Freddy's Revenge, is usually looked at as the dark horse of the series. I'm not really sure exactly why. I think it's a great concept. Freddy, after being defeated in Part 1, is trying to return to wreak havoc by essentially possessing the body of Jesse, a teen whose family has now moved into 1428 Elm Street. It has some really memorable scenes, including the opening dream sequence that revolves around a school bus ride gone very, very wrong. Freddy has more dialogue this time, but he's still dark and scary. After completely taking over Jesse, Freddy goes on a rampage at a party, killing everyone and everything in sight. How is he able to do this? Jesse's body allows him to cross over from dreams into the waking world. The only major flaw I find with this flick is that for some reason late in the film, blades are growing out of his fingers instead of being attached to a glove, although the glove does appear in the film. I don't really get that, but if you can get over it, it's still a decent sequel. And obviously it did well enough because they set it up for yet another sequel. At this point, Freddy throws in a few one-liners, but he's still clearly a villain rather than the psychotic wannabe comedian he'd eventually become. Which brings us to Nightmare on Elm Street 3, Dream Warriors. This is my favorite Freddy sequel. It was also, in my humble opinion, the last Elm Street movie that was even remotely scary. That being said, this was also where we see the first signs of Freddy's transition from badass villain to smartass full of bad jokes.
This is it, Jennifer. Your big break in TV. Welcome to prime time, bitch.
It's also our introduction into the concept of a dream world. As if dreams were some other dimension rather than simply going on inside the sleeping person's head. The movie revolves around a bunch of institutionalized teenagers who are all dreaming about Freddy. Nancy returns from Part 1 to try to help the kids deal with him. Although I enjoyed this movie, as I alluded to, this was the beginning of the end as far as these films being an actually frightening series. The kids all learn to use their dream powers to fight Freddy. Freddy has more dialogue than ever before, and the wisecracks and elaborate dream sequences are ramping up fast. This is when they began to say, fuck the stories, let the effects guys jerk off and throw Freddy in there with a teenage body pool. Also, his voice is all over the place. One minute, it's just Robert Englund's regular voice, then his voice is modified to be Freddy's, then other times it's way overproduced. Take a listen.
Always room for more.
Sorry to keep you waiting, but when you wake up...
Freddy's still dark and sinister for the most part, but the arrogant, self-satisfied swagger that would become synonymous with Freddy began with Dream Warriors. But it's still an enjoyable film if you can get over all of that. In Nightmare 4, the shark is officially jumped. If you don't know what jumping the shark means, look it up. If you do, then you know exactly what I'm talking about. It starts up promising enough. Some returning characters from Nightmare 3 are the first to bear the brunt of Freddy's anger. Although he's more or less still dark and evil at the start of the film, he has too much dialogue, he explains too much, and every kill has to be accompanied by a bad joke. Then it happens. Ah, God. Did Freddy just put on a pair of shades on the beach? Really? And that's it. From here on out, Freddy ceases to be even remotely frightening. The dream sequences are out of control, and a kill and a bad joke go together like a burger and fries.
You can check in, but you can't check out.
The plots get equally ridiculous. Nightmare 5 took the silliness of Freddy to the next level. Now the main heroine, Alice, who beat him in Nightmare 4, is pregnant and her unborn child is dreaming of Freddy. And apparently Freddy thinks he can use this baby to be reborn. I don't get it either. The dream sequences? Holy crap. I think the makers of the franchise knew they fucked this up beyond repair, so it was announced that the sixth film would be the final installment. I think they'd have just gone back to basics and given Freddy a proper send-off. Instead, this turned out to be arguably the most ridiculous entry in the series. The only connection Freddy has in this movie is this supposed long-lost daughter of his. All the Elm Street kids were dead like halfway through part 4, so they had to come up with something, I guess. And of course, they went the 3D route on top of it. Come on, didn't these people learn anything from Friday the 13th part 3 and Jaws 3? Freddy is just a farce at this point and has completed his transition from villain to anti-hero. By now, audiences weren't afraid of him, they were rooting for him. Kind of fucked up if you ask me. You might say, come on Brendan, how bad could it really be? How bad? Tom Arnold and Roseanne are in it. Why the fuck are Tom Arnold and Roseanne in a fucking Freddy movie? But true to form to the last moment, Freddy tacks on a bad joke even to his own death. At least they wouldn't take it any further, I thought. This was the last one. I could forget the last three films in the series and just remember Dark and Sinister Freddy. I guess Freddy's creator, Wes Craven, must have had enough because he attempted to restore the darker version of Freddy with the film New Nightmare. In this film, an evil entity that has been captured by storytellers over the years in the guise of villains has essentially been Freddy Krueger for a decade. But apparently, this thing really likes being Freddy and is trying to become a real version of him. It's kind of a hokey concept, but the movie is watchable. And, quote, Freddy is darker than, say, in Nightmare 5 or 6. And then that all gets ruined at the end. Really? He's trying to eat the kid? Fucking hell. Freddy was dormant for a while, and then we got Freddy vs. Jason. A dream movie for horror fans that had been in the works forever. I know I'm in the minority on this, but I thought this movie was only so-so. Sorry, but the story is painfully standard, not to mention rushed. And this Jason just sucks. If you want to read a script for this film that would have been far, far, far superior, go to the website address on the screen and read the one by Brandon Braga and Ronald D. Moore. Fan-fucking-tastic. But back to Freddy. He's still wisecracking and all that, but they did turn back the clock a little and make him a bit darker than the last few sequels. He was more like Dream Warriors Freddy, which I can deal with. Sort of a middle ground between ultra-dark Freddy and just plain silly Freddy. Then, not all that long ago, the unthinkable happened. A remake of Nightmare on Elm Street was announced. And if that wasn't disturbing enough, it was in the hands of the Abomination of Desolation. The Evil One, the Dark Prince. But you know him as Michael Bay. Having already taken a gonorrhea-infected piss all over Texas Chainsaw Massacre and Friday the 13th, not to mention taking a steaming butt splatter on other aspects of my childhood. Okay, I know I'm in the minority on that one too. I figured I wouldn't bother with this remake at all. It would just be another heralded franchise that Michael Bay wiped his ass with. But curiosity got the better of me, and I watched it. As much as it hurts to admit it, it was actually pretty good. And Jackie Earle Haley's Freddy was a worthy successor to Mr. England. He was the perfect blend of evil Freddy and wisecracking Freddy, which I can imagine would appease fans of both schools of thought. So, after nearly 30 years, we've seen Freddy rise as a scary-as-fuck horror icon, descend into silliness and self-parody, and be reborn for a new generation. What will the future hold for Freddy Krueger? Who knows? I guess when it comes to that, we can only dream.
Read graphic.